Okay. My name is Yoel. I'm from Indonesia, as you can see from my accent. I just landed like 2 hours ago from like a business event in Seattle, and I think I smoked too much weed there. So if suddenly I speak in Bahasa, then you know that that's because of the weed that is still in my brain. Last year I was here too, leading like a workshop about UX research, but today I'm gonna talk a different kind of topic, which is like how to build an effective product design team. I work in a startup called Bukalapak. It's kind of like Shopee. It's one of the 4 unicorns that are currently available in Indonesia. We have around 2,400 employees. 1,000 from them are engineers, product team, design team. And from that 1,000, there are around 121 designers. Some of them are here, actually. They all flew from Jakarta to attend this event. So I will start with this story. Like for the last 7 years, there has been so many things exciting. Like there are so many things happening in the UX world, right? Maybe 6 years ago, 7 years ago, no one knows about what is UX. No one knows what is UX designers, what is interaction designer is. But now, everyone is more familiar with it, and then the team is also getting bigger. I will start with this story. So around 7 years ago, I saw that there is like an opening, like a job opening, that is looking for a UX engineer. I was excited, right? Because oh wow, finally there is a company that is looking for someone in UX field. Because at that time, when I tried to look for some jobs, especially in Southeast Asia, it's very rare that you find a company that is looking for a UX position. At that time, I was still studying in the US. And that company is actually Traveloka. If you know, it's also one of the other 4 unicorns that's in Indonesia. So I applied to that role, and this is my email. Like, to whom it may concern, please find a test my resume and cover letters. Even though there is only an opening job position as a UX designers, actually what they put there is like UX engineers. But I assume that it's actually a UX designers. A UX researcher's position is more interesting for me. I'm pretty sure that you will need this function in your startup sooner or later. So this was like in 2012. I was like, hey, finally there's like an Indonesian company that's looking for a UX role, right? But unfortunately, somehow Ferry, the co-founder of that startup, the company, missed my email, right? So he replied a few months after that, I'm not sure how I missed your email earlier, we'd love to grab a coffee and chat with you. But I was like, shit. At the time, I already took another internship role in Seattle, so I could not meet him again. I was like, shit. If he replied that email, I'll be like a crazy rich Asian now, right? I'll be like maybe like number 7 employee in Traveloka, right? And I'll be like just throwing money like crazy now. But just by missing this email, I was like, now. So like few years ago after that, then they sent me an email again. Hey, we're looking for like UX manager, blah blah blah. I said, no, you missed my email. No more. But what I want to say is like, look at the developments, like. Traveloka, that I can say that one of the best, like a company with the one of the best design team in Indonesia, 6 years ago, could not differentiate between UX designers and UX engineer. But now, like they become like one of the company with the best design team in Indonesia, or maybe arguably in Southeast Asia. So what I'm going to talk today is like. Because the number of like the size of product design team become bigger and bigger, how we actually deal with those challenges, right? Okay, so there is like the first story. But before you listen to my shit, I just give you some background so that you know that the things that I talk to you is legit, right? So. Again, I smoke too much indica. Okay, so the number in the middle is like how many people that I managed during that time, right? So the first one is I studied about UX in University of Washington. The number of people that I lead is one, which is me. And then I moved to Aptio, it's also in Seattle. The number of people that I lead is one too. We are in like a team of four people, one UX managers and three designers. And then I moved to Singapore because I didn't get the visa. I moved to Singapore to get a visa, and then I work in another company, which the number of people that I lead is two people, which is me, and another remote designers in India. And then I work in Singapore for 2 years, but because you guys are so kiasu, I don't really enjoy living here. No, I'm kidding. I think that's because of the weed. No. Then after 2 years working in Singapore, then I moved to Europe to Adidas. The headquarters in Adidas, in Germany, I mean. And the number of people that I manage, like two people, and then three other vendors. Because yeah, Adidas is not a tech company, so you need to work with a lot of other vendors. But working in 2 years in Germany was really fun. I can smoke weed every day. But then I think maybe I really want to work in like a really cool tech company. Right? So then I applied to Uber, and then I moved to Uber like 2.5 years ago. And there, the number of people that I lead is like two full-timers, six people in different countries, and one vendor. But then, because of you, 6 months ago, that you like Grab more than us. That because of you, that you like more cheap discount than better products. Then I move back to Indonesia. Thanks. But now, from 2 plus 6 plus 1 of people that I lead, suddenly I need to manage 50 plus people. There are, this is like a team with around 50 designers and researchers. And after 7 months, the number is double, not even more than doubles. Now we have like around 121 designers, researchers, and UX engineers too. So, it's crazy. I never expect that I will need to lead this like a really big team. So what I do, and then before that, like 2 years ago, I came to this event in London. It's called Leading Design Conference. It's really a good conference, for especially for you who is in manager role. And this is the quote that I got from one of the presenters. He said that the most valuable assets of the 20th century's company is the equipment, but now is the knowledge workers and their productivity. So even though like now there are more machine, but actually the most valuable asset is us, the people. And the other fact is that if people do not see a future at your company, they will find it somewhere else. I guess a third of the people in this company, in this room, are looking for a job in LinkedIn, right? Or maybe a quarter. But actually, the survey say that 50% of employees are actively looking for new opportunities due to poor leadership or management. So if you have 5 people in your team, half of them are actively in LinkedIn at the moment. Half of them are making their resume better and better every day. Although maybe I think the survey is quite biased. Maybe it's like to all industry. I think maybe the number for our industry may be like little bit much lower than that. But that's the fact. And this is like top reasons why people left their last job. The first one is poor leadership management. And actually pay or salary is actually the last one. And maybe the number, this is from, I think I will give you the link of the survey later on. Maybe again the number will be different. Maybe in Singapore, better place number one because of the high renting cost here. But these are like, if you can see, the first four is something that you may not notice. It's about lack of career ladders, lack of meaning, stop learning, and poor leadership of management. So looking at all of these notes that I got 2 years ago when I attended to this conference, the first week when I joined Bukalapak, this is what I did. So I sent an email, and then I scheduled one-to-one to all of those 50 people. I said that in 15 minutes, I need you to present these following four topics. Who you are, your present projects, your past important projects, and the blockers and aspirations. So basically doing like a UX research to own my team, to my own team. And I say that we will spend the last 10 minutes to know more about the interesting project that you share. So I have this like 1 week every day talk to these maybe like 7 to 8 designers and researchers to just know their pain points and to know their aspiration. And from those, basically it's like a UX research, something that I know that this is my forte. From those, then I get this laundry list, which is like some of the problems that my team face at the moment. You can see here, it's not about the design work itself. Sometimes it's like something that is outside of the design work. It's like about the structure, career path, level calibration, performance review, mentoring, how is the working process, how is the design process, and so on. So then from those laundry lists, and we talk one by one how we can kind of solve this issue. So the things that the four topics that I'm going to talk today based on this laundry list. Some of the plan that I made after I kind of figured out the issue that I got from my team. And what are those? There are four of it. The first one is about the structure. The second one is about scaling your team. The third one is about career ladders. And the last one, which I think is very important, is how to get the seat at the tables. Right. Let's start with the first one. I love that the session before me is about active listening, so that I don't need to work quite hard to get your attention. But anytime I see someone opening your phone, I would say, oh, no phone, no phone. Active listening. Okay, the first one is about organization structure. At the beginning, we think that, oh, I just need to get the design right, if you are like a team of two, right? But then, after your team become bigger, you would think, oh, I just need to get the strategy right. But when the team become bigger and bigger, you actually need to change your mindset to be, I just need to get the organization right. This is another quote I found from Twitter. Said, it's interesting to me that we try to design software that doesn't have a single point of failure, but doesn't set up our orgs with this in mind. We do a lot of UX research. We do a lot of design thinking, design sprint of making a product, but we never do that to our own organization. So it's kind of like an irony, right? And this is like the team, the organization that we work every day, that you will need to work with all these kind of people. And when the organization structure is not right, then it kind of make the team to not work effectively. So based on the previous companies that I have worked with, I actually create kind of these models, like four different structure based on how the companies utilize user insight. Again, it's like a very simple framework, just based on the different design teams that I have been part of before. The first one is like a user agnostic. So basically, you only have one manager and you have designers. And you don't really use the insight from users. You basically just design based on three things, right? Competitors, based on design principles, and based on your craftsmanship. Which is fine. That's why we are called designers, because we have the craftsmanship of making good design. That's why we are paid six-figure salary, because we are good in the design craftsmanship. But as the team becoming more mature, then you start to think, oh, maybe I think it's time for us to invite users to our decision. And then you go to the next one, where now the team become bigger, and then you may start doing more like UX research. Usually a company start with the cheapest one, which is like usability testing or survey or interviews. And then the company become bigger, so users inside, you don't use it only to evaluate a product, but also to inform the design. So the first step is you are agnostic about users. The second one, you just use the insight to evaluate the products. And the third one, now it's like another step. You kind of want to inform the design. And it become more complex. Now you have more like a dedicated researchers because it's not easy to do more like a generative research than like a evaluative research. And the product team become usually more kind of structure. So like every product team will have their own researchers, will have their own designers, will have their own data scientists, and will have their own engineers. And each of these product teams will work in an agile way to make sure that the insight that you get can somehow inform the product design. But what is the last one? What is the last step when you can say that the design team is quite mature in terms of using the user insight? I believe that it's a mature product team if they can generate innovation, like a product strategy from the product design teams. So we, as a designers and researchers, are not just like a pixel pushers or like a usability testers, but we actually help the product management. We help the management level, the C-level, to actually decide where the company should go, where the strategy should go, where the product innovation should go. And in a big company like Uber's, the role becoming more and more complex. You have VP of UX, you have design or research directors, you have a strategist, managers, researchers, research ops, design ops, designers, UX engineers, and program managers. When I was at Uber, we have around 80 researchers and maybe around 150 plus of designers. With that number of researchers and designers, you really need like much more like a role like design operation, research operations, program managers to really make sure that this this team can work effectively. So, what I did at Bukalapak is slightly different. So I kind of divide my product design into three. And each of that product design team will have their own design lead and research lead. And the other interesting thing is I created this called like a core team, which basically are design and research operations. What is design and research operations? Who is familiar about design ops? Cool. Who has design ops in your team? Cool. At least there are some, right? But this role, design and research operations, is actually very significant to make sure that your team can run faster than your competitors. And then we also make like a functional teams, like only designers, researchers, content strategists, UX engineers, graphic designers, and illustrators. And these are the core teams. We have called scalable research. I'm going to talk more about that later on, what is the function of scalable research. We have a research team that we call like innovation team, design and research operations, one team that only handle the design system, and a team that handle the conversation between our team and the engineers. Let's talk one by one. So what is scalable research? Scalable research, this is like a struggle that most researchers face, that you are usually only tasked to do usability testing. What your PM knows about research is usability testing. But we as researchers, we hate doing usability testing. It's like a very monotone job. Like you want to do more like a foundational research, generative research, like a research that can be very rich, that not only fixing some design issue, but also generate like product innovation ideas, generate strategy. So, but the PM doesn't care, right? Your PM doesn't care. Your team doesn't care. They want you to fix the designs by doing usability testing. So what we did at Bukalapak is, I don't know whether this is ethically right, but we hire interns. We hire lots of interns to do usability testing. And the PM doesn't need to know, right? They doesn't need to know where does the insight come from, right? As long as their request is met, then they should be happy. And they're happy. I mean, like, I did this at Uber too. Because doing usability testing is not like a really tough job, right? Tough task because it's like a very structured. You don't need to have like that kind of like an art of questioning. It's something that you can teach quite easily, I would say. That's why we have like a full-time researchers kind of lead this kind of minions of interns. That every week they kind of fulfill this usability test request, so that the full-time researchers they can work more on more kind of like impactful research project, like generative foundational kind of research. We also have innovation team. So usually, if you work in like more agile method, you work in a silo, right? You only work on homepage, chat, transaction. There is no one team that kind of look at from the bird's eye view and then see where to win and how to win. So that's why we have this kind of team that is like not part of any agile team, not part of any product teams. To kind of do this kind of innovative research. It's like a team combined of researchers and designers where they can decide what's next. What should we build next quarters? What should we build in the next 6 months? And I think it's very important to put them aside from their day-to-day, like a very fast-paced kind of work. Design ops and research ops, I will explain later on. Design system is kind of like a sexy topic at the moment. But yeah, basically, we also have that team in Bukalapak. So, the next question is like, does your team suffer this issue? Trouble coordinating internally, particularly around process, communications, and file management. Difficulty on collaborating with other parts of the organization. Lack of visibilities. No one knows, no one cares about your team. They just think that you are designers making pretty interface. Duplicated efforts, kind of like doing the same things. Non-existent measurements and fragmented decision making. So if your team are facing this issue, then actually it's time to introduce design ops. Usually you will not face that issue if your team still like two or three people, but when the team's getting bigger, then you kind of will face this issue. So what do design ops do? More like, that's why it's called operation, right? So it's something that is, the background is more, if you are coming from an agency background, this is like the account managers. So they do more like scheduling, budgets, annual planning, compensation, tool and procedures, facilities, IT, communication and coordination, making the process between the team, and so on. I give you like a more like a easy example. For example, research operation are the one who do all the recruitings for the researchers. So that we have this saying at Uber, like let the builders build, let the designers design, and let the researchers research, so that their focus can just do design or research or building something, while the other kind of like cores can be handled by design and research operations. For example, other things like they are the one who kind of manage all the tools that you want to use, all the licenses, measuring the impact of your work, twice a year when you do your performance review, you kind of do not know what you want to write in your performance review. All right, what should I write? What is the impact of my design works? What is the impact of my research work? So research and design operation are the one who kind of make the like the frameworks, how do you kind of measure your impacts. How about design operation? They are the one who kind of becoming like the guard of the design system. Kind of the whippers of, for example, like design sprint. Make sure that designers can learn from other designers. And the other important things about design and design operation is that they can help to bring more about your visibility. Okay. Visibility is very important things. I still remember when I was at Uber, my managers told me, hey, Yoel, you are one of out of other 79 researchers at Uber. Everyone can do conjoint analysis. Everyone can do cool qualitative methods. Everyone can conduct generative research. If you don't have visibility, then you cannot make an impact to the company. Which is true. Like my peers, most of them are PhD. They all know how to do conjoint analysis. If I don't really work on my visibility of my works, then I won't be able to make impacts. The same thing with when I look at my design teams. If my design team doesn't have the visibility, then how can my team can impact the other teams? How my team can be respected by the product teams, by the engineers, by the other teams? How can they believe of what we are saying? So that they don't just think as, oh, those people are just the like indies who like to design things, right? But they actually are not stupid, that they're smart. They can also help the company to drive the strategy. So that's why you need this team to kind of increase the visibility of the design teams. So what they do is like, for example, they send like newsletters once a month. They make these kind of internal events, external events. Sometimes it can be like really petty. For example, we all take pictures together with the same kind of background, the same, and then we all put those in our emails, in our Telegram chat, like a WhatsApp. So then, not everyone think, oh wow, those design teams, what are they doing is so cool, just by taking pictures with the same kind of team. But it kind of help us to increase the visibility of our team. And now other teams starting to ask, hey, can we also do that to our team? It's like a small thing that maybe we never think about that, but actually it improve how we can work efficiently in our companies. That's the first one about the organization. I think there is no one organization that can fit to all cases. Depending on the situation or your company, you may want to decide how you want to structure your product design teams. The second one is to scale your team. Which one that you prefer? Growing your team or poaching? Both? That's because of the width. Okay, growing or poaching? Someone say both, which is true. At the beginning when I joined Bukalapak, I was like, I need much more senior designers. I need much more senior researchers. So almost every evening, I will have like a dinner with designers from Traveloka, researchers from Gojek, researchers from Grab, trying to poach them to break Bukalapak, right? But it's a tiring job. It's a really tiring task for me, like because I'm an introvert person. So every time I need to talk with someone that I do not know, it's kind of drain my energy. So after like 3 months, I said I cannot do this anymore. So now I put much more my effort to actually grow my team instead of poaching from other designers or other researchers. This is example, like I keep doing this in my LinkedIn. Hey Sakti, are you open for a new gig? I use the same kind of like opening line for everyone. But yeah, some of them say, oh no, I already work in Tokopedia. Oh, sorry. So keep doing that. Like, but sometimes I cannot keep doing that. It's a tiring job. And everyone I think knows Sakti. Oh, you know, remember Ramda who came yesterday, who led the research panel? After I send this text to Sakti, Ramda text me, hey, get away from my team. The same thing with Tokopedia. After I try to hijack one of their managers, they contact one of my managers. So, so sometimes at that time during that two months, I was thinking like, am I like a VP of design or VP of recruiting? I'm like, but I came to one stage when I realized I think it's the ROI will be higher if I need to grow my own teams. Because as you can see in this region, there are not many talents. There are not many talents that has like a PhD in UX research or went to like a really good design school like Rhode Island school. So maybe I just need to grow my own talents. So that's what we did in the last few months. So that we actually finally successfully to grow our team from 53 around May to around 121 by like a week ago. So how we do that? The first one is like, I told my team that, okay, so we should not think, at least the recruiting team, the hiring managers, that we should not care too much about where did they study and where did they work before, but just care about their skills and whether they have the like the critical thinking, like the trade-off that they want to learn. For example, this is one of the articles that went viral in Tech in Asia. We have one designer that is like 18 years old. He didn't go to any design school. He just graduated from a high school, but we hired him. And so far, he has been doing really good job. If you will see one of our redesigning, maybe in the next few months, he is one of the team members of that redesigning team. After we hire him, we actually hire more people like him, because it's kind of like this article kind of inspire more of these people who do not may not have like a like degree from NTU and US, but they are just good. They try really hard to go into to go to these industries. So now I think we have two more others designers that just graduated from high school. They didn't take any undergraduate school, but they are really doing good at Bukalapak. The other thing is about diversity. Before I joined Bukalapak, I have this bias that I always respect only people with like a PhD degree if they are like UX researchers. Or they should get like master's degree from Stanford or Carnegie Mellon, or they need to work in Airbnb, Instagram. I kind of always look up at Ang Mo's. But then I kind of learned that that's like a really fuck up thinking, right? And I learned about diversity, that if you only focus on performance here and then low diversity, then you kind of cover only one kind of these circles. But then if you have like a high performance team with a high diversity, you kind of cover more circles. So that's what we are trying to do. We hire people with different kind of backgrounds. We hire people from different kind of age. And we're still working on it. For example, I try so hard in the management level that we should be more open to LGBTs, like to single moms. And can you imagine in Indonesia talking about LGBT and single moms? Like they will throw stones to me, right? But that's what I believe. My team didn't know about this, but but I did this test. So there was like a Pride Day like a few months ago, and I just want to test the water, right? So in our group, I say Happy Pride Day, and I was like, oh, shit, what will they reply? But yeah, luckily some of them say yeah, Happy Pride Day with like a what's that, rainbows, GIF and everything. I was like, oh wow. They are good. Some of them. So, it's not only like that. Especially in Indonesia, they also may have different kind of definition of diversity. They kind of respect people who study abroad, work in a top tech companies, can speak in like perfect English. But I look at my experience. Look at my accent. But Uber hire me. Right? I think if I was my hiring managers and listen to my interview for 5 minutes, I'd say, no. I don't want to work with this guy that cannot even differentiate how to speak shit and shit. Still you cannot differentiate, right? Actually, her name is Susan Portalupi. She's like now a research manager in Instagram. And from her, I learned that, oh, she actually doesn't look someone that looks like her, but that can add additional cultures, additional value to the company. Not looking for a cultural fit, but looking for additional culture that can give like a different kind of perspective to the team. So it's kind of tough for me now, because now I need to kind of learn to do it like him. For example, like I have a very bias toward like Islamic radicalism, right? No bias. It's okay. Right? They add different kind of perspective. I mean, like, but so that's the point, right? When you add diversity to your team, you kind of can make the team to be more innovative because they will bring different kind of perspective, a point of view. The third one, career path. What time size have left? Shit. Okay, sorry. I'll go it very fast. So career path. Companies with career ladders had higher employee engagement, lower attrition, and higher representative people. Sadly, from 100% of the companies, only 23% that has the pay models, and only 5% that has career ladders. Who has a career ladder in your company? Can you raise your hand? Who has a design career ladder in your company? Raise your hand. Right? Good luck. And only 0.4% that have a measurable progression models. And career ladder is very important because it is one of the things that make people want to stay and that they can feel that, oh, actually I grow my skill. I grow my my growth. I have a growth in my company. So what we did, this is the three things that you need when you make a career ladder. A set of established norms. This is what we made for our teams. Like the first one is the hard skill. Can be research, design, copywriting, the impact to the company, how they collaborate with other people, the developments, and the tenures, how many years they have working in that company. You need to separate the tracks between IC and managers, the builders and the managers, individual contributors, I mean, because not everyone wants to be a manager. So that all designers doesn't think that, oh, the next career ladders that I need to go is to become managers. No. We have so many bad managers because we force designers that just like to design to be a managers. Although they actually not managers, they don't have the manager skill. So that's why you need to separate it. And the assessment system for the yearly review. So this is what we did at Bukalapak. From associate designers until senior principal designers. And if they are in the senior level, they can switch into a manager level. They can choose whether they want to be seniors, like really good at your craftsmanship, or becoming a manager. And we make like a very specific, what do you need to do to be able to go to that level. So I told them, hey, let's say you are a designer one, just copy all of the roles in designer two role and make sure that you kind of fulfill those requirements. So there's a target that you can go and that you want to achieve. And we also make this kind of like a self assessment for the like every 6 months you kind of do this for your bonus too. This is the thing that So the last one, sit at the tables. See, this is what we always crave, right? I want to sit at the tables. I want us as designers to have the seat at the tables. But how we can go to that levels? Again, it's like a combination of all of the things, like a small things that we should do to be able to go there. Sometimes we think that, I just need to do good designs. I just need to do good research. But unfortunately, we are in this kind of unfair world where the loudest sometimes can be seen as the authority or the truth. So that's why sometimes we still need to do all those kind of like sneaky things so that we as designers or researchers can also be heard in the company. So these are just some of small things that we did at Bukalapak. First, I will introduce you to this guy, the hippo in our companies. This is the hippo. So, can you not record this? So, he's the hippo in my company. He's also my boss, and he also the one who pays my bill, right? But he's like a guy that know nothing about design, right? For example, he said something like this: "Hey, Yoel, your team is really good at doing design, right? Can you also design our next company, the next building? He means, like the interior design." "Hey, Yoel, your design team is really good, right? Can you design the batik uniform for our companies?" Someone, Dina also asked to do that. So like, he doesn't know any shit about design. But he's my boss and he's the hippo, right? So I kind of need to be the bridge between him to my team and the other product orgs to make sure that for him, he doesn't care about beautiful design, he just care about business, right? GMV, net revenue, profit. He doesn't care if all of the design is like all red or all yellow, as long as it makes people click on it. Hey? So how we handle hippos? Our hippos. First, I show this diagram to him. It's up to you, Wilix. You can choose. You want to be business-centric, or you want to be product or design-centric. And you can only choose one. You cannot force us to be, for example, design-centric, but ask us to design in 2 days. We cannot do that. So just manage your expectation. If you want to be like a business-centric company, that's fine. Then I will make that expectation to my team too. So I think every one of your C-level or management level need to choose where do they want to go, whether they want to be like a product centric or business centric, and there is no right or wrong. You can be like Amazon, Booking, the design is meh, right, or really bad, right? But it's really successful, and it's fine if you want to go to that direction. Or you can be like an Airbnb or Apple, where they only ship things that you like. I just had lunch with one of the designers at Airbnb in Seattle. She again reiterated the same thing. He said that at Airbnb, we will still ship a product even though that new product or new design hit our metrics, as long as they have the conviction that the design is good. Can you imagine that? I will be never able to talk about that to my hippos. Never ever. They will fire me right away, right? It's like they will still ship that product. Okay? But luckily, when you know about this, you kind of can play, make a balance, right? Maybe for some products, you can make it like more product-centric, and some other products, you can make it more like business-centric. So you will not sacrifice all of your teams to do kind of more like design-centric product where you need to do design sprint. We have one tribe called growth, where they don't do any kind of those design sprint things. Because for them, they just need to ship things fast. And as you can imagine, this is like the favorite of Felix. But I'm the one in the middle who kind of need to make sure that, okay, yeah, for those kind of things that is not fundamental, then go ahead. Design in 2 days, go ahead. But for other things that are really important, like redesigning your homepage, redesigning your like a core flow, then it should be like really design-centric. Also, how you kind of design your working models. Do you want it to be more in like a studio culture, or you want it to be more embedded models? And it kind of affect how the product will be made, right? Because studio cultures, it will take more time to do it. We did some pilot in our teams, and some of them work, and some of them did not work. And again, this is a preference, and based on the products that you want to build. Another thing is like this is how I kind of structure every quarters. That we need to do two stuff. Solve the low-hanging fruits of the designs, but also think about the big bold bet. And you kind of need to think which resources I should put on the solving low-hanging fruits, and which resources that I need to do for big bold bet. Those minions, interns, they are solving the low-hanging fruits. These people who come here, that we are willing to pay for their trainings, they do the big bold bet. And they can also do both, but you kind of need to know that not everyone can do big bold bet. Then they will kind of question the value of your team. What are you doing? Like 3 months research and what you are talking just yada 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 yada. I need something. Like Will really say that. What is the product recommendation? What is the design recommendation? I need that. I don't need like 10 whys why Indonesian do not have bank accounts. Right? I don't care. He doesn't care. One of them, the research came from like 2 weeks research to like a remote island in Indonesia. And they came up with this kind of very agency kind of presentation, right? Like a deck where you will kind of make after you smoking a weed, right? And I told them, hey, this is fun. This is fine. If you present this to our team, this is fine. It's totally fine and we will all be happy with this. But if you want to present this to Felix, never do this, right? Then they will cut our research budget. So make sure that you kind of tailor based on your audience. This is the thing I said. We take all of these pictures, make it look cool, that we are like the most cool team in the company, and send our monthly newsletters. And we really got a lot of visibility just by doing these kind of small things. We also do some calibration. So when I joined, I kind of compares the salary of the researchers, designers, and even to engineers. I kind of calibrate the salary. I kind of increase their salary so that I can whip them more. But I think it's important so that, because even though the company has the policy, don't talk about salary, they will talk about salary between them, for sure. So that is very important that someone is kind of valued or getting the rewards that what they deserve it. We also have the values. Share value is very important, so that you kind of have something to rally on together. Right? So we have like an ownership, speak up, and then the Indonesian word for don't be stupid. We also have a lot of these kind of events. Like as you know, most of us, most of my managers, are not like a manager that has like 5 or 10 years experience. So they usually just move from being like a senior designers to be a managers. So we are all clueless. We don't know that how to manage people because it's like two different kind of roles. So that's why I usually invite people from like this. That's Susan, the ones who kind of hire me with this accent. And there's like Molly, like a director in design in Google's, and Edu from Amsterdam, we invite them to come to teach us actually how to actually manage a product design team. And we did a lot of this kind of event. So we do this like called run-up event, like every 2 months. So sometimes we think, oh, why we spend so much energy for something like this? It's actually helped my teams to feel proud of the company. Hey, we are actually part of this cool team, part of this cool design teams. If we don't do this, other companies doesn't know that, oh, there's actually Bukalapak design team. Again, like a small things, but it actually helps to improve the day-to-day job of my teams. Because this is more like improving the internal motivation of these people than like an external motivation of, hey, work, you need to work. We send them to conference, that's why there are some of them are here. And we do also a lot of fun stuff. Small things, but it helps. And it's really important for you to kind of think about this other than design or research work. Something that kind of affect their kind of mental sanity. Because it's like a tough job to be designers and to be researchers. So, these are the results. Last one, okay. Look at that. This is our product detail page. Can you see it? It's like so shitty, right? Can you imagine? These designs still make us as a unicorn. When I joined Bukalapak and I look at the design, oh my goodness. I told them that this is North Korea design. And I told them, hey, I will never use our app until you change that design. And this is our new product detail page. With that new design, we increase our GMV by 7%. That's our homepage, another shitty design. And we change it to be like that. So when you open our app now, there's our homepage. What I want to say, this thing will never happen if I just ask them to work. Right? I just need to make sure that they have like this good organization, good working environment, like good managers to make sure be able to execute this kind of good designs. And you will get these designs if you never think to take care of your teams. You just think, okay, how to work, and work, for sure you will end up with this kind of shitty design. So, the last one, there's a book that is really important. I think if you are new in like a design management role, and there's like the 101, like the Bible for product design, of leading product design teams. And they have like these very theoretical kind of qualities of effective design organization. And you may can see like, the things that we did actually kind of to support all of those 12 points. So we're all in this shit together, trying to get the seat at the tables as a designers and researchers. So I think we need to step up our game so that we can be in the same level to those ex consultants, BCG consultants, McKinsey consultants that usually get the seat at the tables, and to show them, hey, that we designers, researchers are actually smart and not that goblok. Okay, cool. That's our Instagram account, and that's my email. If you have any questions, then just feel free to shoot to that email. Thank you, everyone.
All right. Thank you, Yoel, for such a refreshing session.